So now let us discuss about interfacing of digital to analog converter to 8051. Students, you can find lot of devices which are having the digital to analog converter as part of the circuitry. Okay, all these devices are the equipment whatever you have been seeing on the screen. There are commercial equipments, okay, and have taken only the devices pertaining to consumer electronics, right? But this is not the only field where the digital to analog converter finds its application. This is only for the sake of example, right? Digital to analog converter finds its application in the field of mechanical engineering, in the field of electrical engineering, okay? For example, it finds its application when in varying the speed of the motor, right? And there are in the field of biomedical, and it also finds applications in the health related equipments, okay? To name a few, these are the various fields where the digital to analog converter finds its application, okay? I have only considered the applications pertaining to consumer electronics. That also I have taken only a few examples, right? So you name the device, like it could be a TV, it could be a mobile that you have been using, okay? It can be a music player, can be a CD player, or the stereo system which you have been using in your house. All these will be having digital to analog converter as a part of the circuit, right? This is just to say how relevant is this in the real-time requirement, right? Now, coming to the digital to analog converter, there are various manufacturers who have been manufacturing these devices, okay? So to name a few, we have Dallas, Texas Instruments, Maxim Corporation, okay, Philips, good analog to digital systems. There are a few manufacturers who have been manufacturing the DAC, or rather digital to analog converters, okay? So in this I have considered an example of few ICs that have been manufactured by Maxim Corporation, okay? Similarly, the other companies will also be having their ICs, and each of these ICs have got a few features that are being involved, right? No IC, no two ICs are identical, students, okay? So for example, if you consider MAX5175, it is a 12-bit DAC, okay? Whereas, and it is of low power, so the voltage rating that would have been given for 5175 will be less. But if you consider MAX5322, it is a IC which works with plus or minus 10 nodes, right? So each of these ICs will be having their own features, right? So a few will work with low power, a few will work with the 8-bit DAC, a few will be 12-bit DAC, a few will be 14-bit DAC, right? So the number of bits that you are getting at the input, okay, will also change depending upon the IC, and it is defined by the manufacturer. It is nothing to do with the customer, students, right? So it is decided by the manufacturer. So when you want to buy the DAC, you need to know what is the voltage you are working with, how many bits of digital inputs you are going to deal with, whether it is 8 bit or 16 bit, 12 bit, whatever is the number of digital inputs you are going to deal with, and accordingly you have to choose the DAC, right? So this is just to give you an overview of a few ICs which are available in the market, and that also manufactured by Maxim Corporation. As I said, there are various manufacturers who have been manufacturing these ICs, and all of them will be having their own numbers and features, right? Now, so coming to the digital to analog converter, basically digital to analog converter is a device which will convert the digital pulses to its equivalent analog form, right? And this is how a typical DAC looks like. Okay, this is DAC 1408, okay? This is how a DAC looks like, okay? This 1408 looks like this, and other DACs will look different, depending upon the number of inputs and the pin configuration, okay? All that will vary from manufacturer to manufacturer from IC to IC, right? Now, so here the DAC will normally, as I said, this is the block diagram of a digital to analog converter. We have got, this is a 8 bit DAC. Okay, so we have 8 input lines, right? We have one output line, that is where you are going to get the analog output. We are having reference and we are having read and write pins, right? Now, the digital to analog converter works with two basic principles. Okay, it could be either on binary weight method or on R2R ladder method. In the binary weight method, what happens is there will be having a few resistors. Say, for example, if at all I am having 8 bit DAC, I will be having 8 resistors that are being connected to the D0 to D7 pins, okay, of the DAC, that is within the chip. Okay, that will be within the chip. We are not going to connect everything externally, but within the chip there will be 8 resistors that would have been connected to D0 to D7. Along with these 8 resistors, okay, there will be certain additional circuitry also. Okay, in binary weight method, what happens is if at all I have chosen 1K for D0, okay, the D1 resistor should be 2K, right? D2 resistor should be 4K, D3 resistor should be 8K. Means what? The resistor which I am connected to D1 will be twice that of D0. The resistor that has been connected to D2 will be twice that of D1. Right? Now, see, if at all I am using binary weight method, see here will be you are having 1K, 2K, 4K, 8K, 16K, 32K, 64K. These will be the values of the resistor that should have been connected internally within the chip. You understand? So here what happens is, we know that it is very easy for us to get a standard value of resistor like 1K and 2K. But do we get resistor of 4K in the market? Definitely not. Okay, you will get 3.9K resistor. The next resistor you get, which is standard in nature, is 4.7K resistor. You will not get 4K resistor. Similarly, you will get 7.5 kilo ohm resistor, and the next resistor we can look for is 8.2 kilo ohm, but definitely not 8 kilo ohm resistor. Is it not? So this is the constraint that is there in the binary weight method. So what happens is, the value, because of the variation in the values of the resistor that we are going to connect, there will be variation in the analog output that you are going to get at the output as well. Right? The variation may be minute, okay, but still it is not what we are looking for, it is not what we are opting for. You understand? So this is the constraint. Okay, so what we prefer to do is, we prefer to go for a R2R ladder method. In R2R ladder method, what we do is, the work conversion principle remains the same, but there, instead of using binary weight resistor values, we use two resistors, okay, in which the second resistor will be twice that of the first resistor. Clear? If at all I am using 1K resistor as pull down, the series resistor will be 2K. Okay? And the number of combinations of the resistor multiply depending upon the how many bits I am going to use as the, how many bits DAC I am going to use. Okay? If I am using 4 bit DAC, then I will have 4 combinations of 1K and 2K, or 5K and 10K, whatever is the combinations to use. Clear? This is some preliminary information that you need to have before understanding how the digital to analog converter works, and I think this you should have learnt in your basic electronics and linear integrated circuit parts of the electronic devices. Right? Now, moving on. Now, the digital to analog converter circuit is expected to have very high degree of precision. Okay? Normally, we are going to choose the digital to analog converter based on the resolution. Higher the number of bits, better will be the resolution. Okay, say for example, if at all I am having 8 input DAC, okay, then what is the number of discrete voltage levels that I can have? It is 2 to the power of 8. So how many voltage levels we can have in BT? We can have 256 voltage levels. Right? If at all I am having a 256 discrete values, okay, what will happen? The resolution increases. If I have only 8 voltage level for the same range, naturally the resolution will decrease, right? So we normally prefer to go for 8 input DAC, that is for normal usage. Now if at all you want to have a device with higher resolution, okay, then it would be better to go for a 10 bit DAC or 12 bit DAC. There are DACs with 14 bit also. It would be good to go for such a high input digital to analog converter, right? Okay, now let us see how we are going to interface DAC to 8051. This is the topic of concern. Okay, so here we are going to have digital to analog converter. We have used IC 0808. Okay, this is a 8 bit DAC. Okay, the D0 to D7 pins of the DAC has been connected to the port 1 of 8051. Okay, so we have dedicated port which has been connected here. The supply has been connected to VCC, the V reference has been connected to VCC, the V reference has been connected to ground. The output, whatever you are going to get here at the output of the DAC, is current. Okay, here we are going to get current. Okay, the output current that you are going to get is equal to I reference into D7 by D2 plus D6 by D4 plus D5 by 8 plus D4 by 16 plus D3 by 32 plus D2 by 64 plus D1 by 128 plus D0 by 256. This is the equation, right? If all the bits are 0, if all the bits from D0 to D7 are 0, what is the output current that you can expect to have, students? It will be 0. On the other hand, if all the bits are 1, then what are we going to have? We are going to have 255 by 256 into I reference, which is almost I reference. I out will be approximately equal to the reference current. Clear? So the output current varies between 0 to I reference, which is expected to be the maximum current, right? For a values ranging between zeros to all ones. Clear? This is how the output will be proportional to the input that you are giving, right? Now the output, whatever you are getting here, is a piece in the form of current, right? But what do you would like to have? We would like to have voltage here, right? So then what we need to do, we need to have a current to voltage converter, so that we will be able to get the voltage which will be in proportion to the output current that you are going to get at the digital to analog converter, right? So this is the output. At the output we are going to have certain voltage, and you will be able to measure the voltage. Okay, you can vary the bit status between D0 to D7, and you can also measure the voltage that is available at the output of the operational amplifier, right? Now, so now our requirement is to generate different types of waveform using this digital to analog converter. Okay, prior to that, we need to know how to generate a delay. Okay, so when we are planning to generate different types of waveforms, the waveform includes square wave, rectangular wave, triangular wave, ramp, sine, cos, etc. Okay, now if at all we are going to generate a square wave or rectangular pulse, what we normally do, we expect the output to be 0 for certain duration and high for certain other duration, right? Now if at all it has to be 0 for some duration and high for some other duration, that duration for which it is going to have a constant state, okay, maybe either 0 or 1, is the duration where we have to generate the delay. Okay, now prior to writing the program, we need to know how to write a program to generate a delay, right? So as a prerequisite, okay, let us learn how to write a program to generate a delay. Okay, this you would have learned in the previous module, students, but this is only for refreshing, so that you know you will be able to have a better understanding, and it is as I said, it will be a refresh for you also. Okay, now Here my requirement is to generate a delay of 500 microseconds. Now let us assume the clock frequency is 11.0592 MHz. If the clock frequency is 11.0592 MHz, what is the internal clock frequency? It is 11.0592 MHz divided by 12. So how much is it going to become? 921.6 kHz. Okay. Now, what is the time duration of the each machine cycle? It is going to be 1 by the internal clock frequency. You are going to have a delay of 1.085. You are going to have a machine cycle duration of 1.085 microseconds. Okay. Now, what is the delay you are expected to generate? 500 microseconds. Now, if each one machine cycle is taking 1.085 microseconds, how many such machine cycles have to run so that I will be able to generate a delay of 500 microseconds? Right? For that, what I am trying to do? So, 2 into 1.085 into x. Why 2 means, if I assume that one particular instruction takes 2 machine cycles, then it is 2 into 1.085 into x, that is 500 microseconds. Okay, what is the value of the x? X is equal to 500 divided by this, so it is going to be 230 in decimal or FD in hexadecimal. Right? Now let us write the program for the same. Right? So here we say we will have a counter. The counter has been loaded with FD. Okay, because FD is the value we have got here. DJ NZ R4, $1. This particular instruction move R4, FD will take one machine cycle. Right? DJ NZ R4 will take two machine cycles. Okay? This DJ NZ R4 instruction will run how many times? FD times. Okay? So this will run 2 into 230 times. Okay? 230 in decimal. Okay? Into 1.085. So this will generate a delay of, this particular instruction will generate a delay of 500 microseconds. Okay, and this return instruction will take one machine cycle. Okay, so this will have an additional delay of 1.085 microseconds. Similarly, this move R4 comma as FD, it will also generate an additional delay. So totally we are going to have an additional delay of around 3 microseconds. Right? Now, what is the maximum value you can load this R4 with? R4 is a 8-bit register. What is the maximum value you can load with? 255 in decimal, right? So, if at all I am loading this with 255, and if this counter runs for 255 times, and each running of the counter will take 2 machine cycles multiplied by 1.085, okay, so 2 into 1.085 into 255 will generate a delay of 553 microseconds. Clear? Plus 1.085 from the return instruction plus another 1.085 microsecond from the very first instruction. Right? So that will also generate, I can say, so around 554 microseconds delay you are going to generate. So, what is the maximum delay that you can generate? It is 553.35 microseconds. Okay. If at all you want to have additional delay, then what you need to do? You can add a NOP instruction in between so that you will be able to generate the additional delay. Okay. Where are you going to use the NOP instruction? The NOP instruction will be used here. Okay. So, and instead of giving dollar here, you will be saying L1. And the L1 will be given before to the NOP instruction so that you will have an additional delay. Even if you do so, the maximum delay that you can generate will go up to 750 microseconds, not beyond that. But my requirement will not be in microseconds, all the students. My requirement may be in milliseconds. Right? If your requirement happens to be in milliseconds, then what do we need to do? How many NOP instructions are you going to use? That is not going to fulfill the requirement, right? So, in such case, what we do is, we use two counters to generate the delay of our requirement. Okay, we understood by using a 8-bit counter, by writing a delay program of this, we are able to generate a maximum delay as 550 microseconds. Okay, if we run this n number of times, then we are going to generate 553 into n microseconds as the delay. That is the concept that we are working with. Clear? So, if you see the program that has been written here, see here, we have written move R4, as x. This is the counter value which we are going to load the register R4 with. Okay, R5 has been loaded with Y. DJNZ R5, $. So this instruction will be executed how many times, students? It will be executed Y times. Okay, how many machine cycles does it take? 2 machine cycles. Okay, so this will be executed 5 times. Then what will happen? We are saying DJNZ R4. So R4, it was X earlier. Now it will become X minus 1. Okay, has it become 0? No. So where will it go? It will go to loop. Okay, again what will happen? This R4 will be loaded with Y. Clear? And again we are saying DJNZ R5, $, so it will loop in the same place. Now, how many times will this instruction be executed? 2 is the number of machine cycles into Y times into X times multiplied by the machine cycle duration. Right? Similarly, this will be executed X times. Right? Now, the return instruction will be executed only once and it takes only one machine cycle. Okay, whatever I have put in blue will tell you the number of machine cycles the instruction takes, and whatever I have entered in black tells you how many times the particular instruction will be executed. Is this clear, students? So, what is the delay this program is going to generate? 2 into 1 plus 2 into X plus 2 into Y into X, this particular instruction, plus 2 into X plus 1 into 1 into so many machine cycles. That is the time duration. This could be, if it is 12 megahertz clock, this will be 1 microsecond. If it is 11.0592 megahertz clock, this is going to be 1.085 microseconds. Okay, now by choosing the appropriate values of X and Y, you will be able to generate the delay of your requirement. Okay, now what we normally do is, we will not be able to make this too critical. So, as a programmer, what I normally do is, I will consider this as an internal inner loop. I consider this the one which has been shaded with green as outer loop. Okay, so what I normally do is, I use the inner loop to generate a delay of certain duration. Okay, and I put the value to the outer loop so that the outer loop and multiplied by inner loop delay will generate the delay of my requirement. Say for example, if I want a delay of 1 millisecond, what I do is, I make the inner loop to generate a delay of 250 microseconds. Okay, I make sure that the outer loop will run 4 times. Okay, then what will happen? 250 multiplied by 4 will give me a delay of 1 millisecond. Okay, this may be a vague method, students, but this is what we programmers do, because we cannot spend hours together in just doing this calculation. Okay, the delay whatever we are going to generate will not be exactly 1 millisecond, it may be 1 millisecond with a few microseconds. Right, maybe 2 or 3 microseconds difference will be there. That will be there for sure. Okay, so even if you do exact calculation also, there will be a delay of 1 or 2 microseconds. If at all you want your delay to be very accurate, then I suggest you not to use a delay program, loop program, go for a time. If you want your delay, if you want your on period to be exactly 5 microseconds, and if you do not even want to have 501 microseconds or 499 microseconds, then I suggest you not to use the loop program, instead go for timers. Use the timer and you can generate the delay of your requirement exact to your requirement. If you say 500 microseconds, it will be exact 500 microseconds. You don't even get 1 microsecond plus or minus. Clear? Now, coming back. So, what I normally do is, I use this inner loop to generate, as I said, a delay of a requirement, and the outer loop so that the product of this inner and outer should give me the delay of my requirement. Okay, so here is an example. Write a program to generate a delay of 2 milliseconds. What I have done here, I have tried to make this inner loop, the one which has been colored with brown, to generate a delay of 500 microseconds. I will make this run 4 times. So what is the delay I am going to get? I will get a delay of 2 milliseconds. Right? It will fulfill the requirement. Clear? Now, if you want, what I suggest to use, you write this program. Okay, here is an assignment for you. Write this program. Okay, see how many machine cycles the each instruction will take, how many times this each instruction will execute, what is the delay that has been generated by each and every instruction, what is the delay that has been generated by the program as such. You understand? Okay, so all these details, how to find out the delay that will be generated by this particular program, has been given here. Okay, use this concept for this particular program and find out what is the delay that the program is going to generate. I suggest you to find out the difference between what you are expecting to generate and what has been generated by the program. Right? This is an assignment for you students. Please do that. Okay? Here I have given a few problems for you to solve. Okay, you are expected to generate a delay of 500 microseconds using NOP instruction. Okay, 1 millisecond with NOP instruction, 200 microseconds without NOP instruction, 500 microseconds using NOP instruction, 2 milliseconds using NOP instruction. This is just for you to understand how the inclusion of the instruction NOP is going to have an impact on the delay program. Okay, how is it going to vary the count that you are going to load the registers with, rather counters with. Clear? Okay. So now let us write a few programs, okay, to generate different types of waveforms. Now here we are expected to generate a waveform. Okay. Which type of waveform is that? This is a square wave of 1 kilohertz. Now if the frequency is 1 kilohertz, the time is 1 by f, 1 millisecond. And here it has been told it is a square wave, means what? 50% duty cycle, means on period should be equal to off period. So your on period will be 0.5 millisecond and off period will be 0.5 milliseconds, rather 5 microseconds each, right? And where are you expected to generate the square wave, students? It should be on port 1.0, right? So this is the prerequisite. Now let us write the program for the same. Before writing the program, we need to write the algorithm, right? So what is we need to do here? First we have to send 0 to port 1.0, okay, and we have to wait for a duration of 0.5 milliseconds. Then we have to send 1 to port 1.0 and again wait for 0.5 milliseconds. Again send 0, wait for 0.5 milliseconds. Again send 1, wait for 0.5 milliseconds. This process continues. Right? So this is the algorithm. This is what we need to do. Okay. So send 0 to port 1.0. What is the instruction? Wait for 0.5, send 1, go to step 2. Means you are going to repeat the process. Let us write the program for this. Clear port 1.0, L call delay, complement port 1.0. Okay. So it was 0 earlier, now it will become 1. When it comes next time to the same instruction, it will become 0. You know how the complement bit works. And you are going to SJMP L1. The process repeats. Okay. And here is a delay program. Okay. I have already done the calculation. So we are doing move R4 comma FD. And you are going to loop in the particular place till R4 becomes 0. And using this, you will be able to generate a delay of 250 microseconds. Sorry, 500 microseconds. Okay. This will run 250 times. So you will be able to generate a delay of 500 microseconds. Right? No. If at all you have to generate a triangular wave, what are you supposed to do? You start from 0, go to the maximum value, then again you come back to 0, again you go to the maximum value. Is it not? So first you have to send 0 to the port, increment the value. How long are you going to increment the value? Till it reaches the maximum value. Okay, in this case we have considered the maximum value to be FF. Okay, and then what will you do? You will decrement the value till how long? Till it becomes 0. Once it becomes 0, again you are going to the peak value, right? So send 0 to port, increment the value, send the incremented value to port till it reaches the reference value. I have told reference value students here. Okay, because this reference value may vary depending upon the voltage you are going to give here. Here I have taken the voltage to be 10 volts. If my requirement is only 3 volts, then I am not going to use FF here. Okay, my count will be something different. You understand? Right. So decrement the value and send the decremented value to port. How long will you do this? Till it reaches 0. And again you go to step 1. Going to step 1 is very important. Normally what students do is they will stop at this point. Okay, so when you stop at this point, you think or you assume that you will be getting a triangular wave. But because you are not given continuous loop, what will happen? By the time you have a look at the CRO, the signal would have come and vanished. Would have gone up. Okay, we want the signal to be there so that we will be able to view the signal. That's why we need to give the continuous loop. You understand? Right. So, the program for this is, clear A, you are sending 0 to port 1, okay, are you incrementing the value, you are checking whether it is FF, if it is not FF, you are going to, you are going to move port 1, comma A, okay, L1 should have come here, then once it reaches the maximum value, you are going to decrement the value, then you are sending it to port 1, if it is not equal to 0, you are going to the loop 2 and again you will be looping in the same program. Clear? So on the same lines you will be able to generate the square wave, you will be able to generate ramp and sawtooth waveform. Clear? And similarly while you are generating the square wave, just by varying the time duration, just by varying the delay, you should be able to generate rectangular pulse also. Right? Clear? So, now let us see how to generate a sinusoidal waveform. Okay, so here what we do is, each value here, okay, has certain equivalent value. Okay, there is an equation, Vout is equal to Vm into, right, Vout is equal to Vm plus Vm sin omega t. Okay, so what we normally do is we see the total one cycle is equal to 360 degrees. We see how many partitions we look for. We divide 360 degree by number of partitions. Okay, now if I want 24 partitions, I divide 360 by 24. Okay, then I find the equivalent voltage. Okay, then for that we find the equivalent hexadecimal value or decimal value. Okay, this is the process that we do. This is the procedure we follow. Right? So, here is a table. I said now Vout is equal to Vm plus Vm sin theta. Okay? So, we have taken 24 steps here, students. So, 360 degree by 24 has been taken. I think in this case, we have taken 12 steps. Okay? Not 24. So it has been divided, but the program there has been written for 24 steps. Okay, but this is only for you to have a better understanding. So when I divide this 360 by 12, each angle will have a deviation of, each value will have a step angle of 30 degree. Okay, so it will start from 0, goes to 30, 60, like that it continues. Right, so what is sine theta? Sine 0 is sine 0, sine 30 is 0.5. We will calculate the sin theta value for each of these angles. Okay, so Vout is equal to Vm plus Vm sin theta. Okay, now you find out, we consider Vout Vm is equal to 5 volts, 5 plus 5 into sin 0 is 0, so Vout will be equal to 5 volts. Okay, for 10 volts, the maximum value you can expect is 255. So for 5 volts, what is the value you can have? It is 127.5, so it happens to be 128. Okay, this is the value that we have to send to the digital to analog converter. Clear? This is how the calculation has been done. Now, so you will have these values in the table. All these values would have been stored in the lookup table. Then what we do is we write the program. How do you write the program? Here is an algorithm. Okay, initialize the pointer to the table. Okay, then you know how many steps you want. More the number of steps, smoother will be the waveform. Okay, lesser the number of steps, you will have discrete values in between. You can find the sine wave, you can see that as a step wave rather than sine wave. Clear? So initialize the counter with number of steps. Read the value from the table and send it to the port. Okay, then decrement counter by 1 and you need to repeat the process till you take all the 24 values and send it to the port. This is the procedure. Okay, so initially you are clear accumulator. Accumulator has been made 0. DPTR is pointing to, data pointer is pointing to this particular table. Okay, that is sine wave. Now move R0 comma as 24. Right? So this is the number of count that we want the R0 to be loaded with. Okay. Move CA comma RK plus DPTR. Accumulator is 0. 0 plus DPTR is pointing to this. So what is the value you can expect the accumulator to have? 127. Okay, this value has been sent to port 2. The first value has been displayed. Next, what are you supposed to do? You have to point to the next location. Right? So what I do? I clear accumulator. Students, many times students will forget to write this instruction. If you do not clear accumulator, what will happen? This 127 is already there in the table, and when you go back to this label now, it will be trying to add 127 with some other value. So your accumulator will point to some other location which is nowhere in the permittivity, in the permissible range of the program that you are looking for. Yeah, that should not happen. So what we do not want that to happen. So what we do? We clear accumulator because we want the next location to be accessed. Okay, then increment DPTR. So now your DPTR points to this particular location. Accumulator is 0 and DPTR is pointing to this location, right? Now has R1 become 0? No. So where will you go? You will be going to label. Here what you do, students? You say move CA comma RTA plus DPTR. What is there at A? 0. What is DPTR? DPTR is pointing to the next location, this location. What is in that location? 160. That 160 has been brought to accumulator. That will be sent to port 2. Right? How long will this happen? Till your R0 becomes 0. By the time R0 becomes 0, you have sent all these values to the port 2 and you will be able to generate beautiful sine wave on the port 2. Clear? Okay. So, you will be able to, this is what you are going to get on the port 2. Okay. So, you can whichever the port you are going to use in the program and you will be able to generate the waveform at the digital to analog converter of your IC. Okay, DAC has been connected to the 8051 port, right? And the port you are going to send this. Okay, students, please do understand. On the port you are going to send this. Okay, if it could be your port 1 also. On port 1 you are going to send this, or port 2 you are going to send this. This is only for writing the program. But in the hardware, whichever port you are using, the same port you will be using there also. And whatever the value you are going to send to the port, that will be converted to equivalent analog form value by your DAC. Okay, and that you will be able to see by using the CR. Clear? Okay, so this is how you will be able to generate square wave, triangular wave, sinusoidal wave. As I said, you will be able to generate pulse, ramp, sawtooth waveform, cosine waveform, step waveform. Okay, waveform of your choice by varying the instructions, by varying the program. Right? I hope this is clear to you. Right? So I will end this topic with the quote. As Houston said, students, if you want something in your life you have never had, you will have to do something you have never done. Okay? Every mile starts with a single step. Okay, achieve something in your life. Right? Thank you.